Go. Welcome this Sunday, the 29th of August, to our service of Holy Communion. A couple of notices as we begin. Welcome to those here in church and those joining on Facebook, later on YouTube and on the telephone line. You're most welcome. This coming Sunday, the Sunday the 5th of September, God willing, we will have a confirmation service. Can I ask you all to keep it in your prayers, because we're still waiting for further clarification from the government that they can go ahead. But it obviously is in the diary and in the calendar for 4 o'clock. And please pray for our two candidates, one here from Stranorlar and one from Kiltivog, because it's not been an easy year for any of us. I think for the young ones especially, it's been difficult. And their confirmation service was all about to happen at the end of March, not last year, but the year before. And of course, it and all things like that got cancelled. So if you could keep them in your prayers as they get ready for their confirmation to confirm their baptism promises, and especially that the service itself would go ahead. There's not much else in the notices, because as yet, we're still waiting for things to return bit by bit to normal. But we begin with the greeting. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And continue with the collect for purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that by we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. And that's from Matthew's gospel. Lord, have mercy on us, and write these your laws in our hearts. So as we begin our service, we always put ourselves right with God. We confess that we've wandered away from him and not followed in his will and his ways. Let us then confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace. We in silence confess before our Father in heaven. Let us then return to the Lord our God and say to him, Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first hymn today is Great is Thy Faithfulness. Can you please stand for our hymns?
Oh,
this Sunday. Almighty God, who called your church to bear witness that you were reconciling the world to yourself, help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be drawn to you. Through him who is lifted up on the cross and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. For those in church, please be seated. Our first of our Bible readings, as always, is the Psalm. Psalm 15. Those who do what is right will dwell in the presence of the Lord. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide upon your holy hill? Whoever leads a blameless life and does what is right and speaks the truth from his heart. There is no guile upon his tongue. He does no evil to his friend. He does not heap contempt upon his neighbor. In his sight, the wicked are rejected, but he honors those who fear the Lord. He is sworn to do no wrong and does not take back his word. He does not give his money in hope of gain, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things shall be overthrown. Those who do what is right will dwell in the presence of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now to Elsie, who's reading from James's letter. Thank you.
A reading from the letter of James, chapter 1, beginning at verse 17. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or change or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we may become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror, for they look at themselves and on going away immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark, beginning at chapter 7, beginning at verse 1. If you'd like to stand, please. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come to Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of the disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews did not eat unless they thoroughly washed their hands, and thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you, hypocrites, as it is written, 'The people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' you abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition. Then he said to them, you have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God and in order to keep your tradition. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die. But you say that if anyone tells father or mother, whatever support you might have had from me is korban, that is an offering to God, then you no longer permit doing anything for a father or mother, thus making void the word of God through your tradition that you've handed on, and you do many things like this. Then he called the crowd again and said to them, listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that is going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. When he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about the parable. He said to them, then do you also fail to understand? Do you not see that whatever goes into the person from outside cannot defile, since it enters not the heart but the stomach, and goes out to the sewer? Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, it is what comes out of a person that defiles. For it is within, from the human heart that evil intentions come, fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, and licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, and folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I pray, Lord, that now as we come to your word, you would speak with us, you would enable us to hear and to follow in your will and your ways, Jesus. And may we come to know you more clearly, nearly and dearly, Jesus, in your name and through your word. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus is very much getting to the heart of the matter, what it means to be a person of faith. He challenges what religion is, both then in the days that he was on earth with the Pharisees and even to now. I think it's for good reason that Jesus, the accounts of Jesus is challenging the Pharisees, there's so many of them in the Bible, because oftentimes we can be like them even to this day. And while we know in science that our emotions, our understanding, and our very being comes from our mind, if you will, you won't see any pictures of brains on a Valentine's card, will you? You'll see a heart. So we still refer to it as the heart, even though it probably comes from up here. But as I said, you don't see brains on a Valentine's card. So I want to begin with James. And even though Martin Luther didn't like the letter of James, he called it an epistle of straw, I think he was probably a bit too harsh. Because what James tries to do is he tries to get us to translate, if you will, what we have learned and heard from Jesus and from Jesus of God the Father and the Spirit, and literally put it into practice into our daily life of being, remembering that the first Christians were called followers of the way, of the ways of Jesus. And the first bit here, I think, is most appropriate, because James said, if any of you lacks wisdom to guide him or her through a decision or circumstance, he is to ask of our benevolent God, who gives to everyone generously without rebuke or blame, and will be given to him or to her. But he must also ask for wisdom and faith without doubting God's willingness to help. We need to turn to Jesus for wisdom to be who we are to be, and with others, and before God, and before others. Indeed, in the Proverbs, wisdom is described as a person, and many biblical scholars, when they look upon such readings, see echoes, if you will, of Jesus. So that's one of the reasons why I have a picture of Jesus there beside, because Jesus is, if you will, the embodiment of wisdom. And it's not just intellectual knowledge or not just understanding, it's getting literally to the heart of the matter and grasping who God is, and in turn, who God calls us to be. And God loves us too much to leave us as we are, because he knows that we can become even more and better and more perfect. And that's God working in us before we even get to heaven, which is what Jesus is trying to do. And then James later on goes on to say that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights, life being goodness and purity. And he gives us birth as children by the word of truth, so that we would be the kind of first fruits of his creatures, an example of what it means to be created, set apart, sanctified for his divine purpose. You'll remember that Jesus was of the Jewish people, and there was a reason why he came to the Jews first. The Jews were set apart, not just to be set apart. They were set apart to be the example to the whole of humanity of what it meant to be God's people. Unfortunately, they didn't live up to that time and again, and perhaps to these days, even now, we in the church don't live up at all times to what it means to be God's people. And James is drawing us back to remember that we need to come back to the Father and receive from him. And for me, that reminded me of the picture of the parables of Jesus. He speaks of many gardening parables. He speaks of pruning, being cut off if we don't bear fruit. He also speaks of remaining, and Jesus is the vine. And any of us who are gardeners will know that if we cut off a branch or cut off a fruit, it's no longer going to grow. In fact, it's going to die and wither. And Jesus says we don't continually draw goodness, godliness from God, we will be likewise. And so James is constantly calling us back to remain rooted and grounded in God. And then James goes on to say, but look to those who perfect law, the law of liberty and perseverance, but not hearers who forget and who does not act. They be blessed in their doing. That's picking up the image of James. He might use a curious image of you look at yourself in the mirror and you turn away and you forget yourself. What's James talking about there? Well, we are made in the image of God, so we're to reflect God. So when we look at ourselves in the mirror, when others look at us, do they see God in us? Do they see God through us? And in a sense, if we hear and listen to God's word and then merely, or not merely, but forget it or not take it to heart and try by God's help to do love our God with all our heart and soul and mind and love our neighbor as ourself, then we're like a person who looks at a mirror, turns away and forgets ourselves. We're not reflecting what God has called us to be. We're not working in the image of God. And there we have the words from James, like that in a mirror. So Jesus is asking us to have a change of heart, if you will, either for the first time are many times again. There are times when we've fallen away from God and he's calling us back to himself and saying to us, let's have a heart to heart here. Are you open to me speaking to you? And are you open to me speaking through you, through your life and through your ways? And that's why Jesus really challenges the washing the hands. I don't think he has an issue with cleanliness. He doesn't have an issue with washing your hands. It's very appropriate in these times. But what he's saying is that has become a ritual in and of itself. And if you don't do it correctly or properly, then you're impure or you're incorrect or you're defiled. And Jesus is saying, by heaping traditions on yourselves and on others, you're spending perhaps more time on the act of, in this case, washing hands and kettles, etc., than coming before God and saying to God, how might I better reflect you and follow in your ways, keeping to the two great commandments, for example, love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor yourself. And so the disciples, by not washing, weren't necessarily any more unclean. Indeed, before God, they were probably more clean because they were more attentive to God and to his ways. And so Jesus is challenging us sometimes when we do things that are from a good intention, are from a good basis originally, but they become a ritual in itself, and we lose sight of what they're originally there for. They're there to remind us that before God, we need to be right before him. So Jesus says to us, listen carefully, understand what he is saying, and he's saying that nothing that we eat will make us defiled. And Jesus says, don't forget this, Jesus is talking to Jewish people there, and it was kosher food, and they wouldn't eat anything that was unclean. And Jesus is saying, actually, it's your heart or your intentions or your emotions or your very self, that if that is not in tune, if you will, with God, then that will be the thing that will be unclean. Not necessarily the food or washing or not washing your hands. he calls us back to himself and back to his ways. And so if nothing else, Jesus is trying to remind us again of the two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. As we place ourselves before him, Jesus is concerned with each of us as ourselves, and we can't either gain merit before him by doing things anymore, and we don't lose merit before him by doing things differently. It's not that he doesn't want us to be good or perfect, but he loves us because he loves us, so we can't earn salvation by working hard. We don't lose salvation by not working. What James and Jesus is speaking about, James is repeating what Jesus is saying, is that we do the good deeds and we do the good things out of response to reflect God's ways. We don't do it to earn favor. And then the second part of the commandment, if you remember, is love your neighbors yourself. So that is, as we become more like God, we follow that out by loving our neighbors ourselves. In being kind, in being generous, in being gracious, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. So as we're more open to God and he works to us, that is the Spirit. And so I wanted, as we draw to a close, you might notice that I'm wearing a red stole today. And you might have noticed that the colors in the church are green. I didn't mistakenly put the wrong stole on this morning. I wore it deliberately. Because while what Jesus and James says to us is great and sounds straightforward, we remain in God, God remains in us, and we reflect him in our ways and our thoughts and our intentions. I think if we're honest to ourselves and before God, loving God each day and loving our neighbor as ourselves is sometimes easy, but oftentimes isn't. There are sometimes it's not so easy to love others. It's not so easy to follow in God's ways. Our intentions aren't as pure, or we're not as kind, or we get distracted or distorted. And so the reason I'm wearing the red scarf is the red scarf stole is the one that signifies Pentecost, signifies the Holy Spirit. I know, and I would imagine you too are the same, that in order to better reflect God, we need his help. We have times when we fall down, we have times when we need strength, we are weak, and we need his help. And Jesus said, all who turn to him and say yes to him as Lord and Savior will receive the gift of the Spirit. Remember, he's the counselor, so he guides us in the ways. He's the comforter, he picks us up when we are weak, and he's the enabler. And remember again, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, humility. We need his help. In essence, if you will, the Holy Spirit, to use analogy, building on what Jesus was saying, the Holy Spirit is, if you will, the sap. If we're remaining in the vine, we receive the sap, the Spirit, if you will, of the Father, that comes into us and enables us so that when we look in the mirror, we see something of God in us. And when others look at us, they see something of God in us. But we need to remain in that strength of the Spirit. So that's why I very deliberately wore this red stole, a reminder to myself and I think to us that we need his help to do what is simple and yet challenging. So I pray that we will trust in Jesus, we will totally rely upon him as our Savior each day. But also as we trust in Jesus, we remember that he is the wisdom. He came from God, lived out what it meant to be a perfect life. So in him, as a human and as God, you could see what it meant to be a godly person. In him, you heard the nature of God. In him, we saw the healing and the help of God to the least, the last, and the lost, the widow and the orphan. And in him, he gave us the understanding to know God more clearly. Because God recognized that while the Old Testament is a wonderful part of the Bible, we needed that much more relational, direct contact with God and he with us. So I pray as we take this to heart, that we will go back through these readings during the week and prayerfully say to God, help me to receive your wisdom and trust in you this and each and every day. Amen. So we always have a chance to respond. This is a baptismal response. Can I ask you to stand, please? we stand, the reason we stand is a mark of respect before our Lord and Savior. And before him, I ask and then we respond. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe and trust in God the Son? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated again as we come to God in prayer. As we come to God in prayer this day, we pray for God's grace. That's God's generous, unmerited, and undeserved favor. That is what grace is. And so, hear our prayer. Lord God, through your grace, we are your people. Through the example and teaching and ways of your Son, you have redeemed us. And in your Spirit, you comfort us, you counsel us, you enable us to be your own and to reflect your truth and light in our lives and through our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for people of this, your world. We particularly pray for the people of Afghanistan who are facing uncertain times. We pray for, while it's imperfect, a smooth evacuation of all those who wish to move to a safe or different life. We pray for the people of Haiti who have suffered yet another earthquake upon much trials and tribulations and a land of great poverty and corruption. We pray for the people of the Caribbean and particularly the southern United States. Thinking, of course, of the McClay family there as the hurricane Aida bears down. May it be much less severe than is feared, and would you keep to a minimum or not at all a loss of life? And we pray for this, our world, where in these most challenging of times, we are united in this pandemic. May we remember your commandments to love our neighbors, ourselves, and to think of those who do not have when we have. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this island, north and south, and recognize that this pandemic does not recognize borders. We pray for those who need your healing touch, but we pray especially for our communities. We pray for all those who seek to help and to guide and to govern within this county and with this island, the executive in the north and the government here in the Republic, and the various scientific advisors as they seek to discern what is best in most difficult of times, and they seek to discern the care for all and the care especially for those who are most vulnerable or could be at risk. May we in turn seek the best and the care of others in and through our lives. May we, after James's example, bear witness to your glory in the world, that when others see us, they might see you, see more of you in us, in our care and consideration and our compassion for others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And drawing much closer to home, we pray for those in our own community, especially those who are returning to school this week in Robertson and in Welshtown, and those in secondary school. We pray, Lord, that all the procedures to keep them well and safe will go smoothly and go well. We pray particularly for the second level students who still are facing challenging times. And we pray, Lord, that you'd keep the students, primary, secondary, and tertiary, well, and that you'd keep the teaching and assistant and auxiliary staff well, and that they may know your peace that passes all understanding. We pray for those who are helping those in these times where there is need. We pray particularly for the work of the charity agencies, St. Vincent de Paul and Protestant Aid within our own community, and the various food banks. We think and pray for the work of those who help those who have even less than those in this land, the Tear Fund and Christian Aid and others. May we, in all our works, echo what you have called us to do. And may we challenge those in authority within our own community and across the world to consider those who have so little. And also this time, we come before you seeking your hearing and seeking your healing. We pray especially for Isabel Key's mother. But there are those known to us, often with our own hearts, who need their healing touch. I pray for my own mother as well at this time. Lord, thank you that you are a gracious and generous God, and that you hear the prayers offered to you in faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for James and for all your disciples, both then and through the many generations since then and to now. We give thanks for so many who have gone before us, who have turned daily to you and turned to a heart to heart with you, and have been faithful in your service and faithful in hearing. We remember those who've gone before us, and we give thanks for those who are no longer with us. And in the quietness of our own hearts, we remember especially at this time those whose anniversaries or memories were precious to us, but yet who are no longer with us. We remember them before you now. And may we, in our prayers and in voice, with all your people, echo your will and your ways on earth as it is in heaven. Hear our prayers and make us one in heart and mind to serve you with joy forever and ever. Amen. And merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We now come from the prayers to peace. And Jesus said, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. He also has said in Matthew, if you forgive others their sins, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive you your sins. These are the challenges Jesus places before us before we approach his table and fellowship with him. So the peace of the Lord be always with you. We now have another hymn while I prepare the table ready for communion. If you'd like to stand during this hymn.
Thank you.
Lord, yours is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all things come of you and of your own do we give you. Christ, our Passover sacrifice, been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give you thanks and praise. Father, almighty and ever-living God, at all times and in all places, it is right to give you thanks and praise. And so with all your people, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Father, the creator and sustainer of all things. You made us in your own image, male and female, you created us. And even when we turned away from you, you never ceased to care for us. But in your love and your mercy, you freed us from the slavery of sin, giving your only begotten Son to become man and suffer death on the cross to redeem us. He made there the one complete and all-sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. When he given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way after supper, he took the cup, and when he given thanks to you, he gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, this bread and this cup we do as Christ your Son commanded. We remember his compassion and death. We celebrate his resurrection and ascension. And we look for the coming of his kingdom. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, grant by the power of the life-giving Spirit that we made one in your holy church and partakers of the body and blood of your Son, that he may dwell in us and we in him. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, please be seated for those in church. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. We being many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. Draw near with faith and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Remember he died for you, and feed him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. For those who are joining our service online on the telephone, there'll be a hymn played during communion. And for those in the church who are coming up to receive, please come forward to the chancel step, unhook your mask from one ear, and I'll put the bread in your hand, and please take the little cup of wine. Please come together if you're sitting with somebody in the pew. It makes the administration a bit quicker.
Oh,
say together the prayer after communion. God of all compassion, by the dying and rising of your Christ, you restore us to yourself and enfold us in your love. May we who have been refreshed with the bread of life and the cup of salvation be renewed by your healing spirit and made ready for the coming of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.